Hi, and welcome to Inside Curtin. I'm Jared Dobson. In this episode, we get a sneak preview of the new digital study assistant, which is set to revolutionise student life. We see what our science outreach team have been up to, in space and down on Earth. Meet the man behind the thousands of lecture videos that go up online each month, and hear how a seemingly simple work experience placement led to great things for one of our students. Just like Facebook took the online world by storm, connecting people and information, our own digital platform is taking steps to connect students in a simple, useful way.
The mobile study assistant that we're building is an app for Curtin University students. It's about providing a streamlined way of delivering all the relevant information that the students need, so they've got everything they need at their fingertips.
So assisting them while they're on campus or before they're coming in, and just letting them know, you know, what they've got coming up for their day, so they can plan things, see where lessons are, notes, things that are associated with their study, and really just make it easier to get around and I guess navigate.
It's about their timetable, it's about communication mechanisms, it's about unit information, so all their unit outline information, really everything summarised in a convenient way, in a convenient access method through their mobile phones.
It's where students are, you know, the devices are a really key part of their daily lives, and so we want to be able to provide them with something that, you know, is really useful to them in that space.
When I wake up in the morning, I reach for my mobile phone, I check my email, I check Facebook, so we envisage the students might check their email, check Facebook, and check their Curtin app, and then they might have three notifications. One's an OCC, one's an announcement from their lecturer, and one's about an upcoming event at university. So that's the type of use case that we're envisaging, as well as just general access to all the information they need. It's a smart assistant. It pulls information from a number of back-end Curtin systems and summarises it in a nice way for the student.
Currently it's in development, so we're looking at a smaller release mid-year and a wider release to students in the second semester.
Keep a lookout for the first release later this year. As humans, there is so much we don't know, but bit by bit, science is helping to solve some of the riddles of our universe. And the more people that are involved in science, the more of these mysteries we can unlock, which is one of the aims of Curtin's Science Outreach program.
Curtin Science Outreach run a bunch of programs, and that can include going to schools and doing activities with primary schools, high schools, having them come here to our labs, providing talks to the community and going to events. We would like to just engage people and enthuse them about science and show them what wonderful things that Curtin are doing and what research is being done. One of the other things we do is citizen science projects, which is basically engaging people who aren't scientists to do science and to contribute to real research. Two that we have here at the moment that we've been running, one's called Mildew Mania, and that's been running since 2011. So the Mildew Mania really is about finding out about powdery mildew affecting barley crops. So barley is actually our second most important crop in WA, and at the moment it's being really affected by barley powdery mildew. It costs about $30 million annually in loss to crops, so obviously something that our scientists want to sort out. So really what they've got is schools being involved by growing barley and trying to essentially capture this mildew, powdery mildew, and sending samples back to Curtin. And from then we can work out where powdery mildew is through WA, what sort of genes are involved in their resistance to fungicides, because that is the problem at the moment. The fungicides that we've used in the past just aren't effective anymore. Fireballs in the Sky is a research project which aims to track fireballs or meteors, shooting stars, from seeing them in the sky to actually being able to go out and find a meteorite from that fireball. The data comes in two parts. We actually have a desert fireball network, which is cameras all over the desert area of Australia, so WA and South Australia, across the Nullarbor, and they take photos every night, all night, looking for fireballs. To add to that data, we actually also have a free smartphone app, which is available on iPhone and Android, and that means that anyone who downloads that app has in their pocket something that they can submit a fireball report with. The initial science that set up the money to be able to go big, we found two meteorites within about 100 metres of where the math said they would be, and that's way out in the Nullarbor. So it works. Now we're expanding the network, and we've got more than 30 cameras out, and we're hoping to have more than 100 by the end of next year.
While some students may think iLectures are only there so they can sleep in and attend lectures while still in bed, there is so much more to the 30,000 videos that go online each year, as the man in charge, Martin Hill, explains. And so
I'm going to flip through this. The iLecture system is really designed to capture rich media in all sorts of ways. Lecture recordings, collaborative classroom sessions, student practicals and assignments, and publish it up to the internet with a minimum amount of fuss and, from both the staff and the student perspective. We record up to about 400 lectures and other types of recordings a day during semester, 30,000 or so per year in fact, and we get millions of viewings and downloads of those recordings. We have about 160 venues equipped with automatic iLecture recording systems across campus, and they work allowing staff to just walk into their lecture, present as they would normally, walk out, and then within a couple of hours receive an email saying their iLecture is available. And students can immediately get access to those recordings on the web, all without any human intervention. It's certainly great for those who miss lectures, but those who come along obviously find it extremely useful for review purposes just before exams, to go back over material that they're a little bit shaky on and that sort of thing. And we found that student attendance doesn't necessarily drop much in general. They still appreciate the hands-on, the face-to-face interactions, particularly in a lot of our collaborative classrooms, but they really benefit from the ability to recap and review later on. And of course, if it's a lecture 8 a.m. Monday morning, well, then they have the option of watching from home and so on. For our large numbers of online students, the ability to call up any of their lecture or tutorial or workshop sessions over the web at any time, any place, is a very powerful thing. Curtin's certainly seen as a world leader in that regard. I was asked to present at a UN-sponsored conference in Brussels about 12 months ago, and the institutions represented at that conference were just blown away with what we're doing here at Curtin.
He is definitely the guy with the biggest video library at Curtin. Getting the right work experience position can be difficult and competitive, but as student Emma Wetting still tells us, sometimes taking a seemingly unrelated work experience role can lead to much bigger things.
I started off doing an internship at the Department of Parks and Wildlife in the Aboriginal Heritage Unit, doing a desktop research analysis there. And then from that I was able to make some connections and organise to do a design project in Bremer Bay, which was a student group, and we went down and we produced a resolved design package and were able to go back and present the design to the community at the end of it. And then from that opportunity, and having made some connections in the Great Southern Development region, I was able to also be involved in some similar projects in Katanning. Then I've been able to build upon that network, and I now have an internship at Curtin with Place Activation, which is quite complementary to my degree. I think it's important to not maybe set your expectations too high at the beginning and just get involved in like literally anything and everything, and something that starts off as not seeming super relevant, like a desktop research analysis at the Department of Parks and Wildlife, has ended up becoming an internship that's really relevant to interior architecture, which is actually what I do. So definitely just start with anything and it will go somewhere good, hopefully.
That's it for this episode of Inside Curtin. If you'd like more information on anything you've seen, you can visit the Learning for Tomorrow website at curtin.edu.au. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch you next time.